Hello everyone. I think we can start our webinar now. A very warm welcome to our webinar on TMAP, Quality Engineering and Testing with an Agile Mindset. Just wanted to let you know that we are recording this session and the links to the recording will be sent to you later after the webinar. This event is part of NobelProc webinar series. NobelProc is an international training and consultancy company. It was established in 2005. We have been delivering technical courses for over 17 years and working with tens of thousands of customers all over the world. We specialize in delivering professional skills in leading edge technologies, and we are agile enough to customize or construct our courses and learning programs to the client's needs. So we are absolutely delighted to host this event with Rick Marcellis. Our speaker is going to talk you through the main TMAP approaches to quality engineering and testing. Rick is the author of Quality for DevOps Teams. As you can see at the background, this is the book of Rick. So he's one of the co-authors of that. Other books that he co-authored are also Testing in the Digital Age, AI Makes the Difference, The Point Zero Vision, Quality Supervision, and many others. Rick is an accredited trainer for TMAP, ICQB, and TPI certification. He's an international speaker, consultant, mentor, and coach. So we are absolutely pleased to introduce him today. And hello, Rick, a very warm welcome.
Hello, Natalia. Good morning or good afternoon.
Yeah, so you can post your questions in Q&A box. We will be striving to answer all of them during the session, after the session, sorry, but you can post them during the session. Also, I wanted to let you know that the talk will be roughly maybe 30 or 40 minutes, right, Rick? And we will have 10 minutes or maybe 15 minutes after the talk. We have reserved 1 hour for this webinar, so maybe we will finish earlier. We will see, or maybe we will just be on time. Okay, thank you very much again for joining. And well, Rick, floor is yours. We are very excited.
Well, about thank you very much.
Yeah. Quality engineering. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for your introduction, Natalia. And well, you already did an introduction of me, so I'll go through that quickly. I've been in IT for quite a while. This is what computers looked like when I started in IT. As a principal quality consultant, I do three things. I do assignments for clients, always part-time, mostly consultancy or coaching. I do research and development, which is reflected in some of the books that Natalia just mentioned. And in 2018, approximately, after publishing Testing in the Digital Age, I became interested in DevOps. And together with a couple of colleagues, we created our latest book in the TMAP body of knowledge, which is testing quality for DevOps teams. And that's the main source of what I'm going to tell you today in this webinar. And yeah, one of the things that is quite new is this. Yesterday, it was announced by ISTQB that they have awarded me the ISTQB Software Testing Excellence Award for my contribution to the world of testing. And of course, I'm very honored and glad with that. So yeah, and it also encourages me to continue working on this. So let's see. When I started in IT more than 40 years ago, business people just asked for a computer. They wanted to have a computer no matter to do what. That's it. Today, the demands are totally different. today, business people demand business value. They don't care about IT. IT is a no-brainer. It must be used, but the goal must be to deliver business value. And they don't want to wait. So they want quality at speed. Therefore, IT delivery teams must act maybe somewhat different than they did in the past. All people in an IT delivery team must take responsibility for quality engineering, and QA and testing must be integrated in the process and in the people. And to make that happen, there should be a focus of having high-performance cross-functional teams. And in DevOps, the main idea is you build it, you run it. The same team that creates IT stuff also has to make sure that it is operated and that it works properly. And then to achieve the quality at speed, obviously we need to automate stuff. And sometimes people say we need to automate everything, but I would like to warn that automation itself is not the goal. So please automate as long as it is useful. Now, looking at that business value that our business people want to deliver, we have said, let's start with the scope of business delivery. And from the scope of business delivery, then the stakeholders should define what kind of value do they want to deliver. And it may be something huge like an IT system, but most of the time there's small value adds like adding a button or a choice or a form or whatever. And then we get in the scope of IT delivery. And the first step in the scope of IT delivery is define the objectives that must be met to be able to fulfill this pursued value. And in defining the value, the objectives, you should care about building in quality, and that's done by applying relevant quality measures, because there are dozens of different quality measures, and you need to select what quality measures will help us in reaching these objectives and generated this pursued business value. But then also you want to know if you are reaching your objectives. And that is done by measuring indicators. And measuring indicators is mainly testing. So testing delivers the information to the stakeholders. And based on this information, stakeholders determine how much confidence they have that the pursued value will be achievable. And if they have enough confidence, they will decide to take the IT system live, and then we get in the scope of IT use, and then the end users, they will experience the real value, and then something interesting happens. They will have new ideas for extra value. So then we have this value improvement loop, and if you work DevOps in a Kanban approach, this value improvement loop will be gone through like several times per day, probably. If you use Scrum, it will be once every 2 weeks or 3 weeks, depending on your sprint length. And if you work in a traditional way, it may be a month or 3 months or even longer. And of course, the more you deliver pieces of value, the smaller these pieces of value will be, but the faster you can adapt to the wishes of the stakeholders and the end users. And why is it called the voice model? Well, probably you already figured out that the first letters of value objectives, indicators, confidence, and experience spells voice. So that's why we called it the voice model. Now, talking about indicators, there are many indicators possible. And in our book, we described some 1.5 pages of different indicators, but all of them fall apart in three main groups, which are indicators about the product, the process, and the people, and an extra group. And I'll show you some examples, but I won't go in all the details. But a little word on the fourth group, which is quality. And that's the indicators that relate to problems. Problems that have been found, for example, by testing. And once in a while, I come across managers, typically project managers, that say, we can go live if we have less than three major problems or less than three showstoppers. That's something that they sometimes say. And then I always respond to them, if you want to go live with less than three showstoppers, my advice, don't do any testing, because then you won't have any problems that are discovered and you can go live tomorrow. And that is often the first step in these people realizing that it's not about the number of problems you find, it is about the quality you deliver. And that's why the indicators related to product, process, and people are more important than the quality related. However, still, there are some problem-related indicators that are very useful. For example, the number of anomalies registered versus expected. Suppose you're doing a sprint, an agile sprint of 2 weeks, and normally you find about 20 anomalies. This time you find 200. Definitely there's something wrong. Look into it. Otherwise, normally you find 20. This time you only found two. Maybe there's something wrong. Of course, it can be that we all became perfect overnight. You never know. But most of the time, something is wrong. So the number anomalies expected is an interesting indicator. And another interesting indicator is the mean time to fix operational failures. Because if you're very quick at fixing things, then you can accept a lower level of quality when you go live. Because if something goes wrong, you can easily fix it. Whereas if the mean time to fix is very long, you need a higher quality to be able that you deliver your service. Now, these are just some examples of indicators. In reality, there are many more, but keep in mind, don't use more than somewhere between 5 and 10 indicators. Because if you have more indicators, then you spend most of your time measuring your indicators instead of delivering valuable IT. I already talked a little bit about the IT delivery models. And traditionally, we had the waterfall and the V model. But people that today claim they are doing waterfall, in my experience, are always doing V model. So true waterfall, we don't really see it anymore. But V model is still quite around. However, today, DevOps is what most organizations want. I don't say they already are there, but at least they want it. So you can imagine that's an important reason why we put DevOps on the cover of our book. However, DevOps, in my opinion, is the next evolution in working agile. And that is, we use the term high performance IT delivery for all sorts of agile. And so Scrum is also part of that. And although the focus of the book is on DevOps, most of it also applies to Scrum. And even we have hybrid IT delivery, which is also founded on the agile mindset, but has some mix with sequential IT delivery. For example, a lot of organizations, larger organizations I see today, they have the so-called demand supply model, but most of the time they don't realize that. Because demand supply means the business people, they don't think in cycles of, for example, 2 weeks like in Scrum. No, they just think in their business cycle, maybe a quarter of a year or half a year, and they think this is what we want to achieve the next half year. And then they deliver those requirements to the supplier, the IT people. They work in an agile fashion, and then when they're ready, they transfer the product again back to the business people and they can release what was delivered. Another thing is agile at scale. If you are in a large organization with many agile teams, then basic Scrum won't help or won't help enough. So you need something else. And in our book, we take the Scaled Agile Framework as a reference model. There are multiple models for Agile at scale, but we thought the Scaled Agile Framework is a nice reference model. So basically, the today's state of quality engineering, like we describe, is about the Agile mindset, Scrum, DevOps, demand supply, and Scaled Agile Framework, and some other ways of implementing these things. A little word on DevOps. And I also would like the chat box or the Q&A box used for this, because in a few moments, I'll ask you a small question. But first, let me explain the fundamentals of DevOps. So on the left, you see Dev, which is the development side, and on the right, Ops, which is the operations side. And you see the infinity loop. And DevOps is always shown by an infinity loop, and that is because DevOps takes the starting point that you do have an IT system to support your business, and you are changing it to add extra value. So in the middle, we see the fundamental activity monitor. We monitor both the dev side and the ops side, and if there is any reason to change something, we start the cycle, and the first fundamental activity we see then is plan, where we do not just make a plan, but also think about requirements, maybe some specifications or other things. So it is all about what do we want to achieve. The next fundamental activity is code. And of course, that is about program code, but it's about more, because it's also about, for example, infrastructure as code, if you use cloud infrastructure, for example, for testing. And even documentation as code, if you want to store your documentation in your configuration management and version control system. When you have created something new or changed something, it needs to be integrated with the already existing system. So that's the integrate activity. And then it gets deployed to the live environment. And then we get to the operate activity, where we make sure that it keeps on running. Now my question, and please answer the question in the chat or in the Q&A box. I don't mind, I can see both of them. Is there something missing in the DevOps activities? Is there something that you would have expected or that you have seen before in this infinity loop and that you think, hey, why is it missing here? And now I'm wondering if the chat really works. I don't see anything coming in yet. And if not, I'm filling it in myself, because I've asked this question many times already to audiences. And one of the first things that audiences most of the time say is, hey, there's no testing in this infinity loop. And then I challenge you, where would you put testing? Would you put it behind code, between code and integrate, because you want to do unit testing? Or maybe between integrate and deploy, because you want to do integration testing or acceptance testing? But wait, shouldn't we review our requirements? So reviewing is also testing, static testing. So that should be done after plan. So the answer is it should be everywhere. And that's why testing or quality assurance is not a fundamental DevOps activity, but it is all over the place.
That was a tricky question, actually. Thank you.
Yeah. DevOps has a number of principles, and these principles, they come from this book. I hope you can see it, the DevOps Handbook, created by Gene Kim, Jess Humble, Patrick Dubois, and John Willis. And actually, Patrick Dubois is the man that came up with the word DevOps. He just glued development and operations together. I think it was 2009, so some 13 years ago. And at that moment, he definitely didn't think that he was making a term that would change the IT world. If you look at the DevOps principles, you probably notice they align very nicely with the Agile Manifesto, and of course, that is not without coincidence. Now, there are quite a number of definitions of DevOps. And what we did is, based on all these existing definitions, we made this definition. And I'm not going to read all of it out loud, but the core of the definition is DevOps is a cross-functional systems engineering culture. So it's a culture. It's a way of working together for people. And the DevOps culture is based on the Agile mindset. So the Agile Manifesto fully applies. And you can implement DevOps with the Scrum framework, like I already mentioned before. But you can also use other ways. And one of the ways I know is this one, site reliability engineering, which is the approach of Google to implementing DevOps. And more and more organizations are now adopting Google's site reliability engineering for their DevOps implementation. But many other organizations just build on their Scrum experience that they already had to make DevOps work for them. So that briefly explains DevOps. And then within DevOps, we have cross-functional teams. And with a cross-functional team, I mean a team that has multiple members who can change roles. People in a cross-functional team don't have dedicated functions. So it's not the idea that somebody is a developer and does no other tasks than just development tasks. No, in a cross-functional team, any team member is allowed to pick up any task they think they can handle. So, for example, my main skill is quality engineering and testing. So if I'm testing, that's fine. But then if I see an easy development task, I can pick up that task. Yeah? And because I have some development experience, so an easy task I can do just as well as a developer. And the other way around, a developer should also contribute to some testing. And maybe at the end of the sprint, when everything has to be deployed, then maybe multiple team members pick up the operations tasks of deploying. So in a cross-functional team, nobody has the monopoly on specific tasks, and everybody is allowed to switch roles. But keep in mind that, of course, everybody has their specialties and their weaker spots. But together, the team is able to achieve everything. And the good thing of such a cross-functional team is that if one team member is, for example, on vacation, the rest of the team can continue the work. And this is in contrast to multidisciplinary teams, where everybody is on their own island. And if somebody is failing, then a particular type of task is not executed anymore. And that explains the title of our book, Quality for DevOps Teams. And an important part of that is quality engineering, because our body of knowledge, the TeamApp body of knowledge, is about quality engineering and testing with your agile mindset. And quality engineering, that's a relatively new term. I think it started becoming popular about 4 years ago. There was not a really clear definition. Oh, and by the way, I see a question here in the chat box. Is this DevOps definition an ISTQB definition? As far as I know, ISTQB has no definition of DevOps yet. And in that sense, I think ISTQB is somewhat lagging behind, but that is by the nature of ISTQB, because it's a large consensus organization. We have the advantage that we have just a small group of people to align to release new knowledge. So we're running a bit upfront, but I'll be happy to support ISTQB in getting the DevOps definition in the ISTQB glossary. Anyway, the next definition is about quality engineering. And what is it? Well, quality engineering is about team members in this cross-functional team and their stakeholders taking joint responsibility to continuously deliver IT systems with the right quality at the right moment to the business people and their customers. Now, sometimes I hear people talking about the highest quality, but we don't need the highest quality. Most of the time, good enough quality is much better than the highest quality, because the highest possible quality usually takes very long. And remember, the business wants quality at speed. So the focus is the right quality at the right moment. And quality engineering is a principle of software engineering concerned with applying quality measures to assure the quality of IT systems. So it's all about building in the right quality level. And quality engineering is part of high-performance IT delivery. And high-performance IT delivery is an approach that enables our cross-functional teams to continuously improve the products, processes, and people that are required to deliver value to the end users. So here again, you see the focus on business value, and you see the three important parts: product, process, and people. And then when we were improving TMAP and writing this book, we thought about all the activities that you need for QA and testing. And there are very many different activities. We made a list and we came more than 50. And of course, that's not workable. So we combined activities and grouped them in 20 topics. And these 20 topics, they consist of organizing topics, which have activities that have a scope for multiple teams. And we have performing topics with tasks and activities that are done within one team. Now, this division is not totally black and white, because, for example, you see the organizing topics, estimating and planning. And of course, you would like to have a similarity of estimating and planning over various teams, but also there will be estimating and planning within one specific team, of course. Keep in mind that these topics are all important. You cannot dismiss one or more of these topics. If you're busy implementing quality engineering, you need to think about all of these topics. But some topics you think about every day, like, for example, test design and test execution, and other topics you think about once in a while, for example, quality and test policy. If you have created your proper policy, then it will be valid for a couple of years, hopefully. And then you may wonder, how do these topics relate to the DevOps infinity loop? And our first thought was, we'll just map the topics to the fundamental DevOps activities, and that's it. But that is not how it works. So therefore, we created this picture that you can also see on the cover of our book, by the way. And this picture indicates that all of the QA and testing topics relate to the DevOps activities. So this picture helps you remember that the activities are related to multiple of the, the topics are related to multiple of the fundamental DevOps activities. And then about testing, we talked about quality engineering, and the basic focus of quality engineering is about building quality in, making sure you get it right first time, and have a focus on preventive quality measures. However, within quality engineering, we also have testing. And the focus of testing is on detective quality measures, because testing is about providing information about quality and risks, and it is about measuring the quality. And there you need quality measures that give you information about, is the quality okay? And if it's not okay, you may detect some problems. So that's how they relate. And then you may wonder, what is the definition of testing? Well, the definition of testing is this. Testing consists of verification, validation, and exploration activities that provide information about the quality and the related risks to establish the level of confidence that a test object will be able to deliver the pursued business value. Let me give you an example. On my desk here, I still have an old-fashioned calculator. And suppose we are writing a requirement for this calculator. So this calculator is my test object. Now, in the requirement, it says 1 + 1 = 3. Well, that's obviously a typo, but nobody noticed. So it says 1 + 1 = 3. And then we do verification. So we get the calculator, we do 1 + 1. And if the result shows 3, that's a pass, because verification is checking if it does what was asked for. Luckily, we also have validation, and that's looking if it is fit for purpose. Now, any math teacher will tell you that 1 + 1 definitely is 2, so validation is a fail. But now comes something extra, because you may have heard a definition of testing being verification and validation, and we added exploration. Because when I was in high school, very long time ago, we just got these calculators, and very soon one of the kids in the class entered a number, turned it upside down, and we could read funny texts. Now, I'm sure that nowhere in any requirement or specification document anyone has ever written that you should be able to make funny texts with your calculator. That is something you discover with exploration. Now, of course, this is just a funny example, but imagine you're doing security testing. Then you need verification to see whether security is according to specs, validation to see whether you can do the things you are supposed to do, and exploration to see whether something else is possible. And especially there you get your ethical hackers who see if there's nothing possible that should not be allowed. All of this gives information about quality and the related risks. And based on that information, the stakeholders will get confidence in the delivered, in the delivery of pursued business value. Now, in test design, you need both experience test-based testing and coverage-based testing. And experience-based testing focuses on exploration. Coverage-based testing focuses on verification and validation. And very important here is that you always combine these two, because we just saw the definition is verification, validation, and exploration. So you need a combination of the two. And that is, for example, important if you do test automation, because test automation is coverage-based testing. So you always need some manual exploratory testing to complement your automated testing. But also, if you do exploration, then keep in mind that you also need some coverage-based testing. Now, I told you we have several roles, and I would like to briefly go through one quality measure for each of these roles. And of course, there are many more quality measures, but unfortunately, we only have about 40 minutes, so and time is going fast. So let's pick one quality measure per group. And by the way, what is a quality measure? It's a group of activities that is aimed at achieving a certain level of quality. So let's first look at business analysis. In business analysis, you need common understanding. So it's not just the business analyst thinking about the wishes and desires, requirements of the business people and how to translate them to useful specifications. It is an approach where representative of the various capabilities in the team get together and do a review. So a Four Amigos session is typically an static testing, reviewing of documents like a requirements document. And we already knew the Three Amigos session from the Agile community, And in DevOps, of course, we add the operations people. So therefore, we now have the four Amigo session, and people in the review, they take the different perspectives to think. For example, if you're an operations person, you think, will I be able to get this live and how can I keep it live? Whereas a developer might think, how can I build this? So there are different perspectives needed. And because of this perspective-based reviewing, the result of the review is much better than if you only do an individual informal review. Next to development. One of the things developers often do while unit testing is they talk about code coverage. Now, code coverage demonstrates the percentage of the program code that is covered by test. So that sounds very nice. But there is a little trick, because sometimes they say, we have reached 100% code coverage. That doesn't say anything, because you first need to know what kind of code coverage. And suppose this is our code. If a larger than 10, print yes, and if. So it's a very simple piece of code. Now suppose I will test this with one test case, and the test case is that I put in the number 5. If 5 larger than 10, no, it's not. We're ready. We don't print. In this situation, I didn't execute everything. Still, I have 100% line coverage. That's why line coverage has a sad smiley. If we would have taken the test case 20, then we say 20 larger than 10. Yes, it is. Print yes. And if. At least we have now tested every statement. So statement coverage gets a yellow smiley. It is somewhat okay. But of course, in an if statement like this, we would like to test at least every decision outcome. So therefore, decision coverage is the lowest coverage measure that is acceptable in unit test coverage. Well, there's much more to test coverage, but I'll quickly move on to the next one, which is testing. And in testing, we talk about test design. Now, keep in mind the process of testing is we have a goal, which is the pursued value, the requirements, the specifications, and the quality risks. And then we will design tests. And that may be coverage-based testing or experience-based testing, but it will result in having test scenarios consisting of test cases with test data, and they are constructed based on test situations. If you do automated testing, you also need test scripts to run your test tools. And then if you're ready with your test design, you come in test execution, where you will execute tests. And in my opinion, the most important part of testing is assessing the outcome. And especially if the outcome is not as expected, then we will need to dig into that. Now, I already told you we have a coverage-based testing and experience-based testing. For coverage-based testing, there are 4 groups of test design techniques, and I'll go into this in a little detail on the next slide. And for experience-based testing, there are 4 approaches to experience-based testing, where exploratory testing is currently the most used approach of experience-based testing. And remember, always combine coverage-based and experience-based testing. I already said there are many test design techniques. I've done some survey, and I have found that there are in the world about 25 to 30 test design techniques. But in TMAP, we have this list of 16 techniques that are your starting point, you might say. And I'm not going into much detail because I don't have the time for that. If you would like to know more, well, just you look, for example, on the TMAP website or in the TMAP book. Then operations. Operations people have a specific quality measure, and that is the measure of feature toggles. And by the way, you see some more quality measures mentioned here, not necessarily operations quality measures, but just general a list of quality measures. And feature toggles are about influencing the activities of your system while it is in live operation. And for example, the release toggle, and I don't have time to explain them all, so let me just use the release toggle. Suppose we have a web shop, and tomorrow morning we would like to start a discount for the people visiting our web shop, and we want to start it tomorrow morning at 8. Now, of course, we can do a very tricky thing by releasing the new version of the software tomorrow morning 1 minute before 8. But if something goes wrong, well, then we won't have the discount in place and our customers will be disappointed. So what we do is we release the software already before, for example, right now, and then we toggle it off. So the functionality is there, but not available to the end users. And the only thing we have to do tomorrow morning at 8 is toggle it on, and then they'll have it available. And that's a way of influencing the behavior of your IT system without actually deploying new versions of the software at a specific moment in time. So I've told you a little bit about quality engineering and testing based on TMAP. And one of the big conclusions is that in the old day, testing often was seen as the messenger of bad news. But that is no more, because today we have quality engineering as the enabler of having an adequate quality level that delivers business value. And that's the main goal we try to achieve. If you would like to know more, well, one of the things that we created for the TMAP body of knowledge is a series of training courses. We have the TMAP Quality for Cross-Functional Teams, which is aimed at everybody in a cross-functional team. So all people around a DevOps team or a Scrum team, they will benefit from this training course. If they would like to dive deeper in the performing topics, remember the two groups of topics, then we have high-performance quality engineering. And if people would like to dive deeper in the organizing topics, we have the TMAP Organizing Built-in Quality at Scale. All of them are 3-day training courses, and for all of them, there are exams provided by ISQI, which is an international provider of all kinds of IT exams. And we are very glad that we are working together with them. And of course, we're glad that we're working together with NobelProg to deliver training courses. Also, if you like to know more, you can go to tmap.net. This is the main page. And if you scroll down on the main page, you get this kind of information. You can click anywhere, get more information. You can enter the search field, whatever you like. Also, we have downloads of the syllabi, because with every exam, there is a syllabus that describes what's in the exam. And you can even download sample exams. If you would like to follow the latest news on TMAP, then go to the LinkedIn group TMAP and the World of Quality Engineering. And that brings us to the questions and answers. And well, we managed quite nicely. We still have at least 10 minutes available for questions. And so far, I don't see a question yet. So if anyone has a question, then please post it. Or did I miss something, Natalia? And do you already see questions here?
Yes, I've got a couple of questions actually for you here. I don't know what the question box you can see. Well, thank you so much, Rick. That was really, really interesting and insightful.
You're please welcome.
Post your questions in Q&A box, and you will get a chance to win a digital version of Quality for DevOps Teams book, which is very exciting.
Yeah.
All right. So, well, I've got one question which arrived during your talk. Do you think that AI and machine learning can take over testing anywhere soon.
Do I think that AI and machine learning will take over testing? Well, like I said, we wrote a whole book on it. So the book Testing in the Digital Age. So I can talk a lot about this, but there are parts of quality engineering and testing where AI will definitely be very helpful. For example, currently we have a service using AI and machine learning to generate synthetic test data. As most of the people probably know, test data is always trouble, especially since we have GDPR with all kinds of privacy regulations. So you can't use live data in your test environment. And that's where AI and machine learning can help very well in making synthetic data. But remember one of the other things I mentioned, where you have assess outcome and investigate the results of your test execution. And especially if the outcome is different from the expectation, so you have a failing test case, well, it is my expectation that at least for the next 10 years, AI will not be able to do that kind of investigation. So we still need people in quality engineering and testing. But like with any kind of tooling, AI and machine learning also will be a thing in the toolbox to support doing efficient and effective quality engineering. Mm-hmm. I hope that answers the question.
Thank you very much. So it will be more support rather than taking over completely the whole procedure.
And that's similar like you now see in autonomous cars. There are some autonomous cars, but still you need to keep your hands to the wheel and it's supporting you. So,
Okay, before we go to the next question, I would like to encourage the participants to send more questions, please. And please ask more questions and you will get a wonderful chance to win the digital book for free. All right, the second question is, it's something about mutation testing. Interesting. Mutation testing, what is this? Because some software engineers...
Mutation testing.
Talk about mutation testing.
Yeah, well, the funny thing is when we were writing this book, when we started writing this book, and what you must know, Abby, there are four authors on the cover. And two, being Wouter and myself, are people with a quality engineering and testing background. And the other two, Berend and Dennis, do have a development background. And I think it was Berend who first mentioned mutation testing to me. And then I thought, oops, I thought I knew a bit about testing, but I never heard of mutation testing before. And then, well, of course, Berend explained and I researched a little more. And then we found that mutation testing is not about testing your product, but it is about testing your test set. So it's something that's done by developers. If you have a unit test and your unit test runs fine, so all the test cases pass, then you would like to know, is my test complete? And what you then can do is change your code. Because if you change the code, then it is wrong, because it does something different than it initially did. And then at least one test case should fail. And if none of the test cases fails, then your test set is not complete. And that's a nice way of making sure that especially unit testing is good enough. So apart from having a certain coverage level, which you try to achieve using test design techniques, you also have some sort of a check to see whether your testing is actually good. Now you may imagine that changing your code to see if all the test cases pass can be quite a lot of work. And therefore, luckily today, there are very good mutation testing tools that actually do one little change, then run the test. If something fails, they change it back, change something else, run it again, just as long as they have tried, the tool has tried all the changes. And if every time a test fails, then it's good enough. Otherwise, the tool gives an advice to change something. Mm-hmm. So that's mutation testing.
Okay, that's very interesting. So for those ones who posted the questions, I posted our contact details in the chat. You can contact us using these email addresses, and then we will make a draw of of a free book, free digital book, Quality for DevOps Teams.
Okay, great.
All right. So, well, I've got one more question actually here.
Ah, very good.
From myself. Does TMAP stand for anything? Is it an abbreviation or what does it mean?
Today, TMAP is just the brand name of the body of knowledge for quality engineering and testing. In the past, TMAP started as being a useful abbreviation, because what I didn't mention is TMAP exists for more than 27 years now. And this is the very first TMAP book. And back then, you see, it was written with two capitals and two lowercase letters. And then TMAP really meant something. But today, it is just a brand name. And that is because the T in TMAP was about testing, but today it is about quality engineering. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, our first thought was we need a new name. But then, especially Berend and Dennis, being the development people in our team, they said, yeah, but we are used to the term TMAP and we know that it's related to quality and nobody cares if it means something or not. It's just a term that we know and let's stick to it. So therefore, TMAP is now just the brand name of
the
body of knowledge for quality engineering and testing.
And when was the book released, the one that you showed? About the very first TMAP book?
The very first book was released in 1995. So that's 27 years ago. And currently, and the current book is the latest book in this TMAP body of knowledge. But over the years, it's more than 27 years, I think. Well, I you can't see it, but I have my whole shelf with TMAP books here. And it must be at least some 20 different books that we created over the years. Something in the chat now. Let me read. Claire says, our organizations do not have quality engineers within the DevOps squad. QE roles needs to be played by all in the team. I'm developing organizing level artifacts, but struggling as QE is a shared responsibility. Are there TMAP templates available that support DevOps? Let me start with the first thing. In DevOps, you do not necessarily need quality engineering or testing people, people with a business card saying tester or something, but you do need quality engineering and testing skills in your DevOps team. Now, some organizations say, we want to go DevOps because then we don't need testers anymore. Let's get rid of all the testers. That saves a lot of money and a lot of discussions and trouble. On the other hand, unfortunately, that often also decreases the quality level. So basically, you do need quality engineering and testing skills in a team. Now, there are roughly two different ways of getting the skills. One is making sure that the people in your team have these skills, for example, by educating them or coaching them. And another is by adding people to the team that have these skills. So therefore, I often advise companies to still have some quality engineering and testing professionals in your DevOps teams, because no company has ever said, we want to build Java software, but we don't need skilled Java developers because anyone can program Java code. So anyone in the team is allowed to do Java programming. That's the same about quality and testing. Everybody is capable of doing some quality engineering and testing, but there are some very specific skills where it would probably be wise to have specific skilled people for that. But if the people in the team are skilled enough, fine with me. And that's why we talk about roles and not about functions. And then the second part of your question is about templates. Well, please go to tmap.net, and there you will see several menus. And one of the menus is downloads, and have a look at the downloads that we have. And hopefully there are some templates that will actually support you. And by the way, if you are missing templates, we are always working on further improvement of the body of knowledge, because that's one of the starting points of high performance IT delivery, that you continuously improve. Well, that's also what we do. So we continuously try to improve the website and add extra templates and tools and other things. So I hope that answered the question properly.
Thank you very much, Rick. Yeah, that was really helpful, I think. And thank you for your extensive answers. So thank you all for joining us today during this webinar. And for those ones who asked questions and got their answers, obviously, please contact us, because we are going to do a prize draw among those ones who answered questions. And you will have a lovely chance to win the free book. So yeah, Please contact us, Noble Proc in the Netherlands or Noble Proc in the UK, doesn't matter. We are one team at the moment. The webinar will be available on YouTube. We will send the link to you as well and the recording of this event. Also, you can find us on LinkedIn and online. Just search Noble Proc UK, Ireland and Netherlands. Also check our TMAP courses and a broad offer of other IT-related courses, including soft skills as well. Thank you for your engagement. And so have I forgotten anything? No, I think everything is already covered regarding the prize draw and our emails. I posted our contact details also in the chat. Well, thank you very much, Rick, again. And congratulations on your ISTQ BTST Award. That's a really great achievement.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I'm very honored by this award, and I'm very glad with the recognition it gives to all my efforts to support the quality engineering and testing community. And it also encourages me to continue doing that for the next couple of years.
Very well done. We are really happy and excited to have had you today. Well, thank you again. And I hope meet you on other events of Noble Proc, either webinars that we are going to organize. Also, please send our requests if you would like to cover any other topics during our webinars. And I think we are going to, I see also some comments in there. Okay. Comments saying thank you very much to Rick.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thanks everybody for joining this webinar. It was my pleasure, and good luck on quality engineering and testing.
Thank you very much. Have a lovely day. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.